Well, reporting on the morning after having collapsed the entire history of Judeo-Christian speculation and debate, and explained that it's finished, it's over. Absolutely, it is finished and it's over. It was pretty rough yesterday, but I got through it. I'm okay. I slept. Yeah, but it was very, very intense. But somebody had to say it. Being a student of Jesus, this is my job, this is my role, and saying that, you know, the church age is over. Not only that, but the entire Judeo-Christian tradition was preparing for right now. So it's finished. Now we go into a new dispensation. So the entire debate collapsed it, absolutely collapsed it. It's finished. No problem going forward. So today is another wonderful day. I don't have any work, so I have to do this work, right? The whole debate about how to reconcile the two natures collapsed. There are no two natures. See, it's the end of the debate. We don't solve how to put the two different natures together, because that's a pseudo question. It's a false premise. There aren't two natures. There's only one nature. That's divine nature. It's all there is. Here's an example. Let's say I'm pretending to be somebody else. I could do an impersonation of someone, you know, and you're impersonating someone. And now, if you impersonate someone, does that mean you really are that person? There's two natures, and somehow you split your nature into two natures? Of course not. If you're pretending to be someone else, so you're like an impersonator doing their voice, does that mean your nature has been split in two? No, it doesn't mean that. So we're pretending to be dead. The spirit's pretending to be dead. And this deadness we call human life, human existence, the world, nature, this is all pretending to be dead, the realm of death. This is all pretense. We're pretending, like the same way we do, like we do an imitation, you know, or not similar. Does that mean that we're split into two natures? It doesn't mean that at all. We're not split into two natures. So this is the question of how do we reconcile these two natures is a false question in the first place. Okay? So this entire, you know, it's been a side trip. The whole thing's been a side trip. But it's the side trip that we had to go on to now to say, okay, now we understand what side trips really are about. So now we don't need to go on them anymore. So what Jesus just asked us is just feel eternal life. See, we've been pretending to be dead, now pretend to be eternal life. And so all we have to do is just allow ourselves to, what would eternal life feel like? Let's do an imitation of eternal life. Okay, the mind can do that. That's pretty much it. That's pretty much it. So I've done all the difficult work of having to, you know, say all this stuff and get that done, and people, all we have to do now is how does eternal life feel like? How would eternal life feel like? And just feel it. That's all. We're not reconciling anything. We're not making a union between anything. We're just feeling, how would eternal life feel like? That's the only thing. What else does Jesus have to say? You know, people plead to God, God, I'm so sick. God, I'm so this. Jesus says, he says, stop pretending you're sick. It's the mind's pretending it's sick. Don't make illusions true and then try to get rid of them. Don't say, oh, I'm sick. This is a problem. No, the mind's pretending to be sick. Just the same way someone to do an imitation, you know, of a voice or some of a persona. I like to do the Giants manager, Bruce Bochy. You know, I have a deep voice like this, and I can talk like Boch a little bit. Yeah, how was Peavy? Well, Jake, he kept the ball down in the zone. Yeah, he had a slider and a sinker working today, and I thought he worked really effectively. Really a great outing by Jake, and you know, so I like to it's just fun. It's just imitation, you know. Lousy. Nobody can do him very good. But sometimes when you got a real low voice, then you can do Bochy a little bit. I thought Jake had a great outing yesterday. You know, he did what he needed to do, kept runs off the board, and gave his team a chance to win. You know, cliches. I love baseball cliches. It's hilarious. There's nothing but cliches. So you know, if you're pretending to be, you're doing someone's voice or something, persona, it doesn't mean you are that person. So we're doing this death persona. It doesn't mean we're death. We're doing this sickness persona. It doesn't mean we're sickness. We can just like we're stopped doing imitation, doing imitation of the boat, and you stop doing imitation. That's it. Just stop doing it. You just get back to what you are. So we just stop doing this death, sickness, persona, imitation. You know, not really an imitation, it's a pretending. We, imagine it all up. So we just stop doing that. Instead of pretending, because we're so used to pretending, we pretend that we're eternal life. Okay, and this gives us continuity, because we're still pretending. It's too much for us to drop pretending altogether. This is Jesus' message. Too difficult. So keep the pretending. Change what we are pretending on. Change the imitation. Your imitation, imitating this voice, and then you do another voice, different voice. You know, one is sickness, death. The other is eternal life. All right. It's that simple. We're no longer stuck in all these Christology debates at all. Okay, we're free of it. Absolutely free. Everybody is free. Temporary, expedient, all that stuff. And it's finished. So it's the apocalypse. Jesus is already back. And we're now, basically what we're doing now is turning towards, how does eternal life feel? Let's start feeling eternal life. This is the feeling of eternal life. At least my, the mind's pretending of it. And the mind could do a very good imitation of eternal life. Super creative and super great. So absolutely it can. That enables us to still, function here, communicate with the body, because we're pretending this is what eternal life feels like. And then ultimately, we'll go even beyond pretending eternal life and drop the pretense and just be the eternal life that we are. But this there's too much continuity fear in us to do that. So we're not being called to that at all. We're just being called to say, let me feel, how would eternal life feel? And we understand it's a perceptual, it's still pretending, okay? It's an imitation, doing the imitation of eternal life. But we can do a really good imitation of eternal life, actually. So we don't say, Jesus, I'm sick. Heal my sickness. I got this terrible sickness. Jesus says, stop pretending that you're sick. Stop pretending that you're a body. Pretend that you're eternal life. That's all he said. You don't have to keep pretending. You don't have to keep doing this imitation.
I think the bats are really coming alive and really picking it in the field, and we're playing real good ball, and it's showing up, getting a lot of wins here, and I like the way the club is, I like the way the overall outcomes is great. We don't have to keep doing an imitation, do we? We don't have to keep pretending to be sick, do we? Can we just say, that was not necessary. It's not necessary. And if we get clear just to what the whole situation is about, then we can easily see it. Oh, wow. Yeah, let's start pretending to be eternal life. Do an imitation of eternal life here. And the way Jesus healed is that you don't need to pretend to be sick anymore. It's okay. There's no judge. You don't have. You didn't hurt God at all. He said, "Just be assured that you haven't done anything to God. Therefore, you haven't done anything to yourself. And so, you can't be greater than God. So, there's nothing to reconcile. There's no two natures to reconcile. So it's just pretense. You don't have to keep pretending. Oh, and people were just healed instantly. They said, "Oh, I don't have to keep pretending to be sick. Okay, they got it for a moment like that." That's it. We keep thinking, oh, you know, how did he heal? How? No, there's no healing. They just stop pretending to be sick. I mean, forget about this whole thing about healing. You know, this is very misleading. It's not like we're a body, we need to be healed. We're not a body. We're pretending to be a body. It's all in the mind. So just give up the pretense. That's all. You're imitating somebody. Just drop the imitation. You don't have to keep imitating. But we're so into the role. You know, we're trying to prove that we're dead. Again, the basic facts of the situation are that spirit, which is the Son of God, sonship of God, extension of God, idea in the mind of God, totally free, decided, hey, what can I do with my freedom? Can I change reality? Is it possible to change reality? Well, it isn't. It's not possible to change the will of God. But we tried, and then nothing happened. And then he said, well, wait a minute. We said, well, maybe we can do it, because if we die, that means that God died too, since we're one with God. So if we can fake our death, you see, but if we die, how will we know we're dead? And how will we experience being greater than God? Doesn't it work, does it? So we thought, okay. So what we did was we imagined there's this judge who can determine whether we're dead or not. We say, how do we know we're dead? You know, how can we know? We say, okay, we'll make this judge that's able to judge that we're dead. And it'll be this, like, bad feeling that we have. And when that bad feeling disappears, you know, then that indicates we're dead spiritually. We just made this up. We then pretended to be dead. We're pretending to be dead, trying to convince this judge that we're dead. And we think that once this judge decides that we're dead, then that will prove that we killed God, you see, that we change the will of God, which would be annihilation of God. Since we're one with God, we would have to die too, you see. So we think that our pretend death ends up proving that we did change the will of God. And that this guilt, this judge that we've imagined, is the one that determines that we have died. It's able to determine that. And then once we've determined that we've died, then that'll prove that we're greater than God, and that means that we have the capacity to resurrect ourselves from spiritual annihilation and be the new prime creator. So this is just a silly, you know, grandiose fantasy that we're having, that, and none of it's true, because we cannot change God at all. We are eternal life, and therefore all we can do is fake our death. This judge that we've invented is nothing at all. It's just a fantasy. It has no capacity. We can't die, and we couldn't judge that we died. If we could, we couldn't judge it at all. So all this is much ado about nothing. It's not needed at all. This pretending to be dead by spirit, thinking it's a body. So this, imagine these bodies and sickness and death in the bodies. It's pretending to be dead. We don't need it. We don't need it. So we can pretend to be eternal life. We can imitate eternal life. What's the imitation? Do an imitation of eternal life instead. And the body could still remain, because the body's a wholly neutral thing. Wholly neutral, that we're just projecting this play upon it. It's like a screen that we're projecting a play upon. We could project the eternal life upon the screen of a body too. Pretend eternal life, yes. That's what Jesus did. That's what Jesus did. So again, when we're pretending to be dead, this is not some separate nature at all, some separate will. And it's the gigantic mistake was to say that there's two separate wills, but there's some way of uniting them, which is what the basic creeds of Christianity have adopted and been all about. And that's, you know, side trip. It's very much a side trip. That's why Christianity isn't aware that Jesus is already back, because they're operating. They're still trying to figure out, well, yeah, but, you know, we don't understand this hypostatic union thing, you know, and so we just got to keep on, you know, keep blinders on, you know. So it's amazing, but Christianity doesn't realize Jesus is already back. It's always in the future, you know. It's always because at present, their ideology cannot handle the fact that Jesus is back, can't handle the fact that Jesus is here. Because they figure, well, how do I relate to Jesus as human? How does humanity relate with Jesus? There is no humanity. Never has been. There's no question of how does humanity relate to Jesus. That's a ridiculous question. You know, this is just pretense. We're spirits pretending to be a body, pretending to be subject to death, pretending to be sick. All this stuff is 100% in the mind, just pretending, thinking that this is the way to be greater than God. This is paving the way to be greater than God, and it's not paving anything. We're just aimlessly wandering around, meaninglessly, aimlessly wandering around. That's all that we've been doing. So this is the apocalypse, and so we're pushing the pace. But when you push the pace, you find out you can handle it. You know, it's great, and so it's a positive. It's a positive. Now I know people are right now just kind of in shock, like saying, "Wait, and okay, now which way do I gotta go?" You know, and as this becomes clear, you know, you start to say, "Oh, okay, yeah, right. I can pretend to be eternal life. I can do an imitation of eternal life. Absolutely." Let that happen. Let that be my experience. There's no healing. I'm not healing anything. There's nothing, no sickness, nothing to heal. It's just imitation. I just give up pretending to be sick is all. It's very different than healing. When you give up pretending to be sick, how you do it? Pretend your eternal life. That's how you do it. So it's not like, oh, I'm sick, but what do I do with the sickness? Let me, you know, fix it. No. We just say, well, I've been pretending that I'm sick, and now I'm going to pretend that I'm eternal life. That's all. You just shift the pretending. Now, so I've said a lot in the previous videos, this has already been said. It's already been entered into the registry of the consciousness here in this world, that we can be in this world. We can say these. We can say this. We can think this way. It's done. I did it. So it's already done, and then we can move forward now. Doesn't matter how many people listen to it or respond to it or anything like that. It only matters that it's been done. Because we've been thinking, well, nobody can do that here. That's too difficult. You know, it's not possible. Well, yeah, it is possible. Yeah, I've done it. It's already been done. So we can now focus on, let's start, how does eternal life feel? That's all. Not how does a body feel eternal life, how does humanity, no. How does eternal life, the spirit doing an imitation of eternal life. So how does the imitation of spirit of eternal life feel? This is where the mind now needs to turn. Debates are over. So there's nothing to wait for anymore. Except we can start directly doing this. That's all Jesus is coming back for. Eternal life. That's what he told us. I come here to bring you eternal life. You know, to track you to eternal life. And because of the continuity fear, it will first be an imitation. It will imitate eternal life. But it will be a very good imitation. But we can still function here with that imitation, of course. So. The world is frantically busy trying to find cures for all these ailments. who tries to find cures for imaginary ailments, you know? It was the biggest business in the world, by far. Health is the biggest business in the world. Health of the body is all imaginary, which is why everything is really placebos. Again, who tries this? Who's seeking cures for an imaginary condition? This is rather hilarious. And so, in this transition phase, you'll say, well, what do I do? Do I need to take even medicine? Sure, why not? Why not keep taking placebos? Absolutely. Because as long as part of your mind believes that you really, you know, are sick, then you have need for the placebos, right? Absolutely. But gradually, you know, when you start pretending that you're eternal life, you know, the situation is likely to change at some point. But don't do it backwards. Say, well, I'm going to stop my pills, and then that's going to cause me to feel eternal life. No, it doesn't work that way. That's putting it backwards. First, feel eternal life, and then See how you feel. Okay. Meanwhile, continue on with your placebos. So, the situation, the world need not panic and think that's being attacked. It's not. It would be a gradual downsizing, you know, of the whole situation, where there's less, and then a shifting of modalities as it gets downsized, and there's less and less need for placebos. You know, the whole industry diversifies, downsizes, goes into other stuff, and it's like that. It's not, we're not trying to be vicious and say, well, you know, stop the industry and stuff. No. We're just announcing to everybody that this is the option. We either pretend to be dead or we pretend to be eternal life. That's the only two options we really have. Now, it's been very difficult to get to this place, the clarity, because coming into this world, I thought, oh, I should be able to do it, but oh my gosh, the accumulation of 5,000-6,000 years of belief, you know, had to clear it all out. It was a big job. Very tiresome job. But, you know, none of that belief is needed anymore. None of it. We can start completely fresh from this moment, actually. There's nothing that we learned at all. There's nothing to learn here. This is all pretense. That's the only thing is that learning? You know, that's a recognition. There's nothing to learn. We just need to recognize that this is all pretending. The way, similar to how we do, like, a pretend to be some person, do their voice and their persona. We're just pretending. Spirit's pretending. 100% pretense. There's no second nature whatsoever. There's only divinity, and there isn't any nature, you know, flesh nature. None of that. It's pretending. We're very good at pretending. We're super creative at it. So it seems like, wow, it seems as if that there is this second, you know, nature. It's like if we do a really good pretending of some persona, people say, wow, you sound just like them, you know, maybe to me, that kind of thing. Well, it's like, wow, it seems like there really is this other will, this other nature, but there isn't. It's just that we're fabulous at pretending. And when you keep up the pretense, you know, for a long while, keep doing it, then that also lends credence, you know, say, wow, it maybe this must be my persona. This must be the way. The kingdom of death must be real. You know, it must be some sort of separate realm. And how do we unify it with the divine realm? You know, then these are the wrong questions. It's not a separate realm. There isn't anything to unify at all. It's just a spirit is just pretending all this. So gradually, more and more people start breathing the air of authenticity, and we'll start feeling this is how eternal life feels. And this, people say, well, how does that fix my problems? And I say, well, what do you mean? How does shifting from pretending you have problems to pretending you don't have any, how does that cure your problems? This is a ridiculous question. We're not curing the problems. We're just shifting our pretending. There aren't any real problems. So we don't need to solve any problems. There aren't any real problems at all. And we say, well, what if there were? Well, there never will be. There will never be any real problems at all. So why do we need solutions to unreal problems? We don't. The one solution to all unreal problems is to imitate eternal life. That's like somebody who's really thirsty, and you know, there's nothing to drink, and They're saying, oh, I feel so, what's the matter? I feel so terrible. I got burning here. I can't move my body. I'm having delirium. My mouth's like, it's so, I can't hardly talk. It's so sticky. I got horrible symptoms, you know. God, do you please treat these symptoms? And, I treat each symptom individually, like, okay. And someone says, why don't you just drink some water? Why don't you just drink some water? The lack of water is causing all the symptoms. But they say, no. I got to fix the symptoms. I got to fix this. I've got, my delirium. I got to fix this. I need psychotherapy for my delirium. You know, I can't move. I feel so weak. I need energy, shots of energy so I can move and all this thing trying to, and if they just drank the water, all those symptoms would just clear up. So if we stop pretending to be dead, all the symptoms that we're pretending, obviously, they won't be there anymore. These are only pretend symptoms. All sickness is pretend sickness. All symptoms are pretend symptoms, 100%. So there's nothing to cure, right? Nothing to cure. It's just let's pretend something else, pretend eternal life. We have to keep, bringing this to mind because it's like, it has to become, obvious to us and we have to actually then, accept it. We keep thinking that there's all these separate symptoms and we can't imagine how we can imagine all this, but it's just one mind imagining all these symptoms, just the mind. All conditions are imagined by the mind. Yeah, you're not eating, you're not drinking anything, you're so super hydrated. My heart is beating too fast. Give me some heart medicine. I got this burn in my chest. Give me some medicine for the burn. Tingling in my fingers. Give me medicine for this. Demanding all these treatments and medicines, and yet the whole while just drinking the water, hydrate, you feel fine again, you feel wonderful again. All healing is mental healing. All healing is mental healing. All healing is mental healing. 100%. Meaning, just choose a different pretense. Choose a different pretense. Pretend to be eternal life. Well, you say, what about those who are pretending to be sick? Well, they'll continue to pretend, pretend remedies. That's what else they're going to do. They'll continue to take placebos and pretend that they have these pretend remedies. Absolutely they will. That's okay. And sometimes, the people want placebos, like if there's a healing takes place. But how did it happen? They're so scared, I have to have something causing it, other than just my mind. So sometimes the ones with the healed minds will give them some little thing here. Here's a rose, or here's a bracelet, or here's a necklace, or here's a stone, or here's a this. And oh, okay, then there's something that you put your power into the stone and the power is not getting into me. I got this healing stone now that's making me well. That's okay. The clinging to the something has to cause it, not my mind. It can't be my mind that's causing this. No, of course not. So, but that doesn't really get to the root of it. It might even, it could be fine just for people to continue with their placebos until they finally see through this delusion, instead of going around healing people, oh, your cancer's gone, this is gone, this is gone, because then they're going to say, well, wait a minute, how did you do that? We got to do scientific studies, we got to figure out. That doesn't heal their mind. I mean, that doesn't bring the mind to recognition, really. Not really. This may be why the Christian Science and New Thought died out, because they were into healing people, you know. And maybe it's better that we needed to realize, well, that's not quite it either. We're not really healing anything. We're just, because there isn't any real condition to heal at all. We're just shifting our attention to eternal life. So the goal is not how to heal cancer. That's not the goal. The goal is to feel eternal life. Do an imitation of eternal life. That's the goal. And obviously, when you do this, there won't be any affliction. And you don't have to get rid of any affliction. It just there's no, you know, a lot of pretending to have any. That's all. It's like when you're pretending to be a person. When you stop pretending, did you get rid of that person? It's like, how did you get rid of that person? Where did they go? What did you do to get rid? No, you just stop pretending to be that person. So the one issue that we're weak on is pretense, pretending. As long as we refuse to acknowledge this, we're just exercising futility. You know, you're just spinning your wheels. And this is what the world demands. You know, the man said, no, we're not pretending this is real. As soon as you take that step, you're down the rabbit hole completely. Just you're in Mad Hatter's Tea Party. Just like that. Nothing can be explained. You can't explain. All explanations are all tortured and twisted. And people say, what are you talking about? I don't understand. You know, so it doesn't work. You just have to bring the truth. And those who can get with it, get with it. Those who can't. For right now. You can't combine truth and lies. It doesn't work. 2,000 years of trying, we realize now that doesn't work. More than 2,000 years, actually. Yeah, say 5,000 years. Doesn't work. And so we're at a point now realizing it doesn't work. It's led to this catastrophe. Pharmaceutical culture, you know, it's a catastrophe. People are posturing in politics, you know, and saying, oh, I'm going to fix this. They're not going to fix the pharmaceutical culture. They're going to get rid of that? No, they're not. No way. So there's no fundamental change in the politics. It's completely superficial, actually. Eternal life just simply doesn't need it. That's all. You don't heal sickness. You just realize you don't need it. And you realize there never was any sickness, actually. So we're trying to say, no, cancer is real. Well, we got to find a cure for it. No, you just say it was never real. It never real. It was all just pretense. Well, but, you know, you say, well, what if something, you know, some sickness, did become real? We got to learn how. Never will. We perfect eternal life. There's no flaw in what we are. We cannot bring any flaw upon ourselves, actually. We're doing this in the morning time here. I'm a little drowsy. It's been very stressful to, you know, push this through, but it has to be done. It's the apocalypse. It's the unveiling right now. And people are going to get frantically caught up in political solutions, thinking there's something there. There's nothing there, really. Nothing there whatsoever. You're choosing between Tweedledee and Tweedledum, basically. Instead, choose between pretending to be dead and pretending to be eternal life. That's the real choice that we have to make. And from pretending to be eternal life, then we'll realize that actually there's never been any choice at all. There's nothing we need to do to be what we are. There aren't two alternatives, really, between, like, ourself and some other self. There's no alternative to what we truly are, none whatsoever, except just pretending we're something else. That's not really a choice or an option. It's just a whim. So, again, I know Jesus is back. Most of Christianity doesn't. So I'm speaking up as a student of Jesus. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do, is speak up and say, hey, you know, my teacher's back, and this is the teaching. It's very simple, and we can get with it. Time to get with it. We just have to let this sink in. We won't immediately do it, necessarily. Some might. Some, if we're ready, they might, but... Yeah, I'm just saying, wow, yeah, pretend to be eternal life. How does eternal life feel? And we're so conditioned to think in terms of cures instead of just shifting our pretending, you know, that the ego said, no, wait a minute, you know, it sounds like you're feeling better. Now, why are you feeling better? You know, what did you do to feel better? You know, I'm just feeling how eternal life feels, that's all. Ego doesn't understand this. The ego might say, well, it's not really, sickness can attack it. What do you mean? Sickness is all imaginary. That's pretend too. How can, you know, something that's pretending attack something else that's pretending? That's meaningless. You know, it's simply, if I want to pretend to be dead, I can pretend to be dead. If I want to pretend to be eternal life, I can pretend to be that. I'm the one who's in charge. There's no capability to one to attack another, you know, independent of my changing decisions. There's no attack anyway. It's just you can change your decision if you want. So this is what we're where we're at now. This is how we go. You see, there is an amazing remedy, isn't there, for our situation. And so temporarily, my mind is just kind of stunned, like doesn't know what to say. Just this morning, I said, it just came to me, why not just pretend to be eternal life? Just start doing that. How does it feel? How does eternal life feel? Pretend to be feeling eternal life. And that's all I have to do. So, you know, the mind is just like stunned, temporarily stunned. And the mind says, well, what kind of process is there? There's no process. It's pretending, not process. Yeah, but I mean, I have to subject to oscillation, ups and no. That's pretending to be dead. This is pretending to be, you know, eternal life. So it's fresh, it's continuous, it's undisturbed. There's no causative agent of it other than the mind pretending. So the mind has to adapt to this, you know. Just, you hear it first, you start thinking, the mind says, okay, wow. Let me just get used to this. So, you know, you allow full stop in the wow. Neither responding nor not responding, or both responding and not responding. And then we can ask for advice as to how to help us, you know, do this. When the mind will, as the mind begins to adapt to this, it will say, okay, let's get after this. So we're still in this phase here. We're moving, you know, we're introducing the practice, which is really just to feel, experience, you know, eternal life. How does it feel? At least it's an imitation of eternal life. How does it feel? That's the real practice. See, it's a positive thing. We're not practicing how to get rid of anything. We're practicing how to bring ourselves to something instead of getting rid of something. As Jesus always says, don't make illusions true and then try to escape them. Don't try to make them true and try to escape them. That's what causes you the problem. Just simply go, you know, just do something positive, accept that your eternal life. How's it feel? Don't try to get rid of a bad feeling. Instead, think of a good feeling, or feel a good feeling. Because the bad feeling has the exact same origin as the good feeling, which is the mind. You can't get rid of the mind. Trying to get rid of a bad feeling would be trying to get rid of the mind. You cannot. To just replace it with a good feeling. Both of them are pretenses. Dial this back down a little bit if possible. Both are pretenses. But one pretense confirms reality, the other denies it. Now, of course, when we're pretending to be dead, we're pretending that we don't have this capacity. Oh, this sounds like it's important. Yes. Okay, it wasn't important at all, but trivial. That's the problem with the world, isn't it? But we cannot, we have to keep pushing forward here. And we have to actually start doing it, actually prove it to ourselves. There's no other way. If we don't prove it to ourselves, the world will absolutely, you know, try to savage us, you know. Absolutely. Say, you're crazy. Because when we're trying to pretend to be dead, we're pretending our mind is dead. We say, my mind can't do that. Our mind doesn't have the power to pretend we're dead. Because we're dead. How can we pretend to be dead when we're actually dead? It's impossible. You see that problem there? You say, how can I pretend to be dead when I'm actually dead? It's not possible. I can't resurrect myself. That happens once guilt is satisfied. But I mean, I can't do anything about it. I'm dead. This is the problem, isn't it? But we have to realize that we've never been dead. That we've always had the capacity to stop pretending to be dead. It's not resurrecting ourselves from the dead. We've never been dead. How can we resurrect ourselves from the dead when we've never been dead? So the realization is, I've never been dead. I've had this a couple of times where my mind, you know, quote, woke up. I realized I'm not, my mind isn't dead. And I said, oh my gosh, I've never been dead. This has always been here. And it is here right now, too. And we're just not aware of it because we're pretending to be dead. We can feel eternal life right now. At least imitation of eternal life right now. Always. But we say, no. I'm dead, and something has to happen. I can't do it that way because my mind is dead, and it's getting deader all the time. And so that would, you know, that would interfere with my death. I need to have a good death, a complete death. I need a complete death to be saved. This is what the delusion that we're under. That's why they tell us, the only way you can go to heaven is if you die first. You gotta die first. No, you don't. That's complete misinterpretation. It's the opposite. Now, it's not easy to keep your mind on this, is it? Because you think, well, I'm dead. How can I keep my mind on this? If I kept my mind on this, I wouldn't be dead. So we can the overwhelming habit is to keep pretending that we're dead, hoping that this will solve the problem for us, and you know, and then we'll be resurrected from the death, from being dead. And again, we were trusting in this judge we've invented that will acknowledge that you truly died, therefore now, okay, now you can have eternal life. This new life, St. Paul said, well, I have this new life in Christ. This is inaccurate, actually. It's a lot of fundamental inaccuracies. There's not a new life. It's the same life. It's the true life that you've always been. You recognize it. When the instances when I've had glimpses of it, I don't say, oh, this is a new life. How did this came from through some hypostatic union of the divine and humanity have now joined? There's a new. No, I said, oh my gosh, this is the true life that's actually been here all along. This is the life I've always had. This is eternal life. I'm just pretending that I'm dead. I'm dead to this. So they got it wrong. Christians got it wrong, actually, in terms of their interpretation. You know, I have a new life. You know, I got this new life in Christ. The way they expressed it, using Hellenistic terms and trying to Judaic terms and Hellenistic terms, and trying to cobble it together to account for the law and this, and then two different natures. And all. No, we got it wrong. We got it wrong. You have to correct your mistakes. There's nothing wrong with admitting your mistakes. That we have to do that and correct them. So there's not some new life in Christ. We're simply recognizing the life that we've always been. That's always been the case. Eternal life has always been our one and only life. It's the one and only life there is. We've always been that. Just because we're pretending to be something else doesn't mean we stop being that. Not at all. Just like I do, you know, voice imitation of someone doesn't mean I stop being who I am. Not at all. The kind of appearances that we're seeing doesn't stop us from being the one who is producing appearances. Not at all. And this just, you know, has to sink in. We just keep repeating over and over and over. And let the mind start, you know, keep adjusting, keep adjusting, keep adjusting. See, we're assuming that Jesus agrees with Christianity. This is a false assumption. Jesus didn't create Christianity. Jesus didn't write the Bible. Okay, like I say, Christianity doesn't realize that Jesus is already back because, you know, they're looking for the Christian Jesus. And they're looking for a Jesus that agrees with Christianity. Jesus doesn't agree with Christianity, actually. He said, you don't understand what I'm telling you, really, yet. But eventually the Holy Spirit will clarify it for you. And then I'll come back to this place, this realm of pretense. So don't be looking for a Christian Jesus. It's much simpler than that. You know, they're looking for Jesus that they can feel confirmed in their Christianity. Say, oh yeah, there's two different natures, separate natures, hypostatic union somehow made these two natures into one nature, and I have a new life in Christ based on this new creature. I'm a new creature, you know, that divine and human combined into one, producing this new creation, a new creature, and, you know, various ways of that. And Jesus would say, what are you talking about? that's not it. So they're looking for a Jesus that agrees with Christianity, and they're not going to find that Jesus. So, you know, that's why when I saw when Jesus said I'm back, everybody kind of peeking and like, you know, is he going to agree with my beliefs? And they said, I don't know, I kind of feel nervous, you know. Christianity is a belief system struggling to understand, you know, what Jesus came to teach us, to tell us. It's an organic effort to understand. That's all. It's not really set in stone at all. Jesus is not going to come back and say, are you a Christian? Do you believe in the Chalcedonian creed, you know? Say the Nicene Creed? And I want to hear you say it right now. Oh, you forgot it? Oh, you're condemned, you know? No, he's not going to say, are you a Christian? Do you believe in these creeds? Do you know? Nothing like that. He'll say, are you clear about the truth? You know, this is all pretense. You never died, never can die. Never stop being eternal life. You have a continuity problem, so you need to just now pretend that you do an imitation of eternal life. Pretend that you're eternal life. That's it. And the Christian has become someone who makes a profession that there's two distinct natures, that Jesus somehow had these two distinct natures that were separate from one another, and yet somehow they're one, you know. This is what the term, you know, has come to mean, Christian, and this is not true. I don't say I'm a Christian, I say I'm a student of Jesus. I'm a student of Jesus. It's different. Do I believe in the doxology, the teachings of the church? No. Absolutely not. They got it wrong. As Jesus said they would. And as he has said they did, as he's come back. He's very, in the Course in Miracles, journey onwards, he's very harsh towards Christianity and all the teachings and such. He says they got it wrong. Many bitter idols, you know, just wow. And which is why Christians are kind of huffy and puffy about it, you know, like, hey, this, Jesus couldn't say that. What are you talking about? Well, you got to look and examine the beliefs that, you know, the doxology, the teachings, the confessions, the creeds and everything. Look at it, and they're not true at all. It's a mishmash of confusion. And just trying to combine confusion through mystery and ceremony. There's a mysterious comp, something we can't explain. It it's inexplicable, it's there's no way to understand it, but mysteriously it happened. You know, the impossible happened somehow. We have no idea how, because, you know, but you have to take it on faith that it actually happened. This is not so. There's nothing mysterious, there's nothing impossible happening in the mind. There's nothing mysterious actually happening. There's nothing you have to actually take on faith, really. Everything can be, you know, experienced. So, yeah, the world's very slow on the uptake that Jesus is already back. And a little, you know, I can't call it surprising. You know, I told Jesus nobody's going to even be aware that you're back. You know, not going to pay any attention. They're not looking for you. They're looking for, you know, someone who affirms their beliefs. They want to be verified in their beliefs instead of correcting wrong beliefs. It's a problem if you make mistaken beliefs. You can get caught up in trying to insist that they be verified, and that your Savior is one who verifies that the beliefs are indeed right, and that's not a Savior. It's a deceiver. A demagogic deceiver. If you have false beliefs and you just expect they become true by someone verifying them, then you become dependent on some external verifier like that, and instead of your own mind. You see, you're putting the sovereignty that you have external to yourself, to your mind. The term Christian wasn't even used until, you know, it was used in Antioch first, I guess, and after 100 years or so, but it gradually began to be used. But Jesus didn't refer to himself as a Christian or his followers as Christians. Now, you could say it means we're students of Christ, students of Jesus. Sure, that's fine if you want to use it in that way. But the students need to learn the lessons properly, and not ask the teacher to give them an A when they're flunking. Like, so, well, I've got an F here, I've got it completely wrong, but I can't help but get it wrong. So, teacher, could you please give me an A and give me a passing grade? Because I can never get it right. You know, no, it doesn't work like that. Teacher says you have to get it right. You're just not really trying. You know, you're trying. You're saying you can't get it right because you're still pretending to be dead. So of course, a spirit being dead can't get it right. I'm trying, but there's no way I could do it. You know, it's too difficult. It's impossible for me. Meaning, I'm so feeble. I'm almost dead. In fact, I am dead, and I just can't do it. You know, so it's not fair. It's not right. You have to do it because I'm dead. And again, bring it right back to this pretense of being dead is we have to look, keep looking at this and realize that, of course, when we're pretending to be dead, we will seem to be incapable of getting free. Because I don't have any power to do it. It's gone. My mind is dead. I can't do it, and I have to do it by mechanical, physical, robotic, technological means, because my mind is dead. So, of course, the technocratic society is one that those who believe that their mind is dead will get into that. That's the only route they see. Big pharma, big technocratic governance and robotics and all this kind of stuff. This is they'll feel, well, that's the only route I can take. It's the only route. I can't see anything around. My mind's dead. I can't just pull myself out as by pretending to be, something else. That's not possible for me. They say, it's not possible. I'm dead. Maybe for someone else, but not, no, my mind is dead. So this is the trouble. So we try to, I'll try to do a mental healing. Oh, it didn't work. We're still saying, well, of course it didn't work. I'm just proving it can't work because my mind's dead. And of course we think that the mind being dead, the spirit being dead to what it is the key to our happiness and success, happiness. Because we think that only that will then prove that we did kill God, because we too are dead. See, if we die, it means God must have died also. And then that proves that we had a greater will than God, which then we think then enables us then that greater will to somehow resurrect from spiritual death and be the new prime creator, which then we think then we're going to be happy once we do that. The squirrels are really already starting to get eating nuts and getting ready. It's almost, what is today? It's the 30th, right? Something like that. Yeah. Almost August, so yeah. So we're going into August here with full steam ahead. August is going to be a great month. It's going to be an awesome month. How else could it be? I can feel it. Surviving July was a great accomplishment, because the tone of the world now is going towards Tweedledee and Tweedledum and technocracy and big pharma and all of that, saying the mind isn't capable of solving our problems. We have to turn towards technology and drugs to solve how we feel. This is again all based on trying to be greater than God. Therefore, we're trying to prove that we spirit died, to prove that God died, to prove that we changed the will of God, which then means that we have some sort of power to resurrect ourselves from that death. There isn't any death. It's pretend death. So there can't be any real resurrection, because there's no real death at all. And again, did we get it wrong thousands of years ago? Of course we got it wrong. What do we expect? You're gonna get it wrong before you get it right. And now look, hindsight, it's 2020. We should look back and say, oh, wow, yeah, we really got it wrong. But we've now fixed the problems, got it right now. That's the second coming, is getting it right. Now, is everyone gonna get it right now? Well, hopefully, but we certainly are going to, but everybody. Well, that's would be a optimistic viewpoint, right? But we won't jump into that. Really, that's too much for us right now. We already have this wow about what we're talking about here. That's enough. I can feel when something is going to be an overload, so I just say, okay, forget it. We've got enough wow to deal with right now. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead, meaning let those who pretend to be dead take care of those who pretend to be dead. Let them do research on cures. You know, you're not called for that. Called out of that. You don't have anything to do with that. So people say, oh, you got such a smart mind, you should be able to do research and come up with some cures. I've got arthritis, you need to be working on a cure for arthritis. I say, well, let those who believe that any of this is real, let them be the ones who do all the research. I know it's there's no reality to it. It's all pretense. So I certainly what is that? I don't know. I certainly should not be doing any research at all into finding fake cures for fake illnesses. That's a gross misuse of my capabilities. Weird. There's all this stuff on my skin that just like peeled away. Ah, wow. I don't know what that was. Huh. Maybe that's like a fake illness. You know, it's not really real. It wasn't my skin. I don't know what that was. Never seen that before. On my hand. I don't know. Oh, okay. I know what it is. Okay. I get it. Yeah. We have an ant invasion again, and I've been cleaning them up and battling them so much, trying to figure out where they're coming in. I put some silicon on where they got in, and I guess some silicon got on my hand here, but it was a thin layer, and so it looked exactly like clear. It looked exactly like my skin, so I start peeling it off. I thought I was like peeling off my skin. It was really bizarre, but it wasn't. It wasn't real. It wasn't my real skin at all. And it's like that. Like sickness is not our real nature at all. Death is not our true nature at all. It's fake. What's that bird doing? Well, that's pretty interesting. Perfect example of something you think this is real. I thought I was peeling off my own skin. I said, that's weird. It doesn't hurt. But it looked exactly like I was peeling off my own skin. I said, I better not keep doing that. And I figured out, oh, it's silicon. Then I peeled all of it off. Now, you know, there's no harm to my hand at all. See, no harm to the hand at all. But at first I thought, oh my gosh, what am I doing? I'm peeling all my skin off. Great example of what we're talking about. That when we let go of, you know, when we pretend that we're eternal life, then, you know, it's like the, we're taking off, all the sickness just peels away. We're peeling it off. But if we think that's our true being, we say, oh my gosh, I'm losing my true being, you know. And get afraid of it. So our minds have to get used to this, you know, bit by bit like this. Just wow. I hear what's being said, but wow. You know, the mind says, wow. I like it. I know it's true, but I'm really, you know, stunned by it. It's like, wow, is this really happening? Yes, wow. I'm parting ways with the pretend death complex. Like, wow. Yeah. So it's very important to be abstract about it, and don't think that there's all these separate illnesses. It's all one complex of fake symptoms. I peeled some of the silicon off, and I said, oh my gosh, I think maybe I must have had a blister or something. I'm peeling my skin off. I better not peel anymore. And then I thought, well, this is what it is. Then I peeled it all off. But so when we think there's all these different sicknesses and illnesses and stuff, no, there's all one category of fake symptoms. Fake conditions, fake symptoms. We don't have to solve them one by one. They're all fake, equally fake. We just need to choose eternal life, that's all. There's no order of difficulty in dismissing fake symptoms. So we don't even need to judge it at all. Doesn't need to be any judgment involved. Judgment would be meaning, yeah, well, okay, you know, how difficult was it to get rid of cancer, and how about Alzheimer's disease, and you know, and okay, what, you know, put, categorize them in difficulties. They're equally nothing. There's no degree of difficulty to talk about or judge at all. Fake symptoms. All sick illness is fake symptoms. Equally, just completely fake. Just completely pretense, 100%. So there's no order of difficulty in pretending something else. It's not like we're extricating ourselves from these symptoms. We just realize don't need to pretend we have them anymore. That's not an extrication. It's not a cure or an extrication. We're just pretending to not have these symptoms. That's all. None of them. We don't go one by one, well, I don't have this cancer symptom, and okay, I don't have this. No, I'm not pretending to have any of these symptoms. It's eternal life. I'm pretending I'm symptom-free. Death-free, symptom-free. Right now. No order is needed. No judgment is needed. We don't need to say, well, first I need to do this, then this illness, and then this, and then all the mental conditions, all the physical. No, there's none of that. It's all at once. You just say, I don't have any symptoms of discomfort or illness at all. Symptom-free. Completely symptom-free. That's all. And the ego say, well, which one was more difficult? None of them are difficult. There's no order of difficulty. So we're just doing a big push here, and because Jesus is back, and so, you know, at least this student is speaking up, and I mean, different students will go about it in different ways, and those who can get with it early on will get with it. That's all. And this will snowball. It's, you know, snowball in some way. And it needs to, right? Because, you know, apocalypse, then the tribulation, this is how it goes. You can see there's a battle between Tweedledee and Tweedledum in terms of, do we want the old, you know, aggrandized, glamorous society, or do we want a technocracy, which is also glamorized, but it's a, you know, who controls the dialogue here in the world? There's, you know, a tremendous battle. Tweedledee and Tweedledum are battling this out. American election is all about that. So, a lot of very, 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 you know, sharp, edgy feelings, getting more and more so, will get more and more so. So, to feel eternal life, you don't get back in your mind of categorizing. But which symptoms did I get free of? All of them. Which symptom am I more free of? No, I'm free of all of them, equally free of all of them. But which symptom did you get free of first? I got free of them all at the same time. Well, didn't that cause an extraordinary upheaval? No, because I didn't cure anything. I just chose to be symptom free. I'm just experiencing, you know, I'm symptom free. I'm experiencing eternal life. So it wasn't gentle, no. Just a change in pretending, that's all. See, I didn't do it physically, I did it mentally. Mentally, it's just gentle change in pretending. If we tried to do it physically, then, you know, it'd be some terrible upheavals and stuff, but no. That's not how we do it. How are we doing? We're good. Okay, we've done well. We've done very well here. Putting a push, continue the push here. So that we don't get engulfed by the apocalypse. We surf the wave of the apocalypse. We don't get engulfed by it. We're on top of it. We're surfing it. Surfing the wave. Surfing the apocalyptic wave. As the world fights over who's going to be in charge of helping us cure our symptoms, you know, and deal with our symptoms. We're not engaged in that at all. We're not curing symptoms. We're just choosing to be symptom free. Just like symptoms are a choice to have symptoms, we're just choosing now to not have symptoms. Sickness and death. That's all. There's no cure. There's no cure at all. The idea of cure means that it means something other than the mind involved. You know, there's nothing other than the mind involved. And of course, those who believe they're dead have to believe in cures, that something other than the mind can make them feel better. Because the mind, they say, is dead, or is almost dead, or is so close to death that it can't function properly and can't be the cause of being symptom free. They think we have to do something other than that. So we go to material sciences, chemistry, drugs, surgery, all this kind of stuff, right? Physical therapies and everything like that. So still recording, yeah. So it's been a tough time for sure. It always is these days for everybody. It's a big push in July. Big push. I slept a lot, took a lot of naps, had to. That's the only way to keep going. Might go take another one now. But, you know, the heavy work's already, heavy lifting's already been done. So people can relax. They don't think, well, I've got to conform myself to some, you know, some creed or some belief before I can meet Jesus. And I haven't quite been able to accept this creed entirely. So I still feel guilty. And so I can't quite talk with Jesus because I'm not ready. I'm not truly dead yet, you know, and I can't be judged as dead and be resurrected. And the whole premise is wrong. The whole premise is wrong. Jesus didn't come to me and say, hey, you dead yet? I said, you know, he said, no, I'm back just to relate to his friends who wants to relate, you know. He didn't interrogate me about Christianity or anything. So people are under the strain, saying, yeah, Jesus is back, but, you know, how can I convince him that I'm a good Christian? Or how can I, how can I convince him that I deserve to be saved? Or, you know, that I died. None of that happened. They don't need to do any of that. We'll say, yeah, but I kind of believe that. Well, we have, but that's what mistakes we're correcting. So we can gradually, the wow is the way to go really fast, and don't agree, say, well, I'm both agreeing and not agreeing. Just go into neutral mode. Just don't judge against truth. Like that, that's all you need to do. And good Christians think, well, I got to welcome Jesus back. I got he must be here to fix the problems of the world and cure the illnesses and do this and that. And I got to be able to help, but I don't feel quite able to do it. You know, of course, because we're not dead yet. You know, so I can't. I'm not quite dead yet. You know, I still feel like I'm holding out somehow, thinking that Jesus demands our death. You know. It's the death of pretending to be dead that he demands, you know. It's not really demand, but just, you know, this is what needs to happen. And he's not coming back to seize control of the governments and produce a bunch of good pharmaceutical pills for all our problems and stuff like that. Not at all. He's just encouraging us to practice that we're now pretending to be eternal life. That's all. That's it. No big agenda. Does Jesus have big plans, big agendas? No. But he conveys that to us. Like, oh, it's simple. You know, I'm not burdened by some big agenda or plan or anything like that. Just the truth is very simple. You exchange pretending to be dead for pretending to be eternal life. That's it. It's not all burdened down with some, you know, like, oh my gosh, I've got this massive plan, and how do I do this and this and this and this and this. So he remains true to the simplicity of it. See, this is why he is what he is. He's able to remain true to the absolute simplicity of it. So when people asked him, are you coming back? He said, well, I don't have any plans. Didn't say he wasn't. When I say, who asked him those in A Course in Miracles who apparently had some sort of contact with him, mental contact. It was asked, someone asked, are you coming back? He says, oh, I don't have any plans at the moment. It's that simple. So he didn't want us to think of him as somebody who has this vast strategy and vast plan and blueprints, and it's all complicated, and therefore we have to, like, just be these little, you know, ants, like, carrying out the roles, the scripts that Jesus has for us, and there's this intricate, great plan and everything like that. No. If we thought that, we'd have such trouble, right? Like, how can I even approach Jesus? It's not like that at all. He doesn't have any plan, except just the truth. You know, just exchange your pretending. That's all. There's nothing more than that. It's when we get into thinking, well, I can't do that, Jesus, I'm dead, that we project upon him the belief that there must be some vast, you know, plan about how to do it without the mind doing it. It's like when we think the mind's dead, then we say, well, how do we get to be happy? Well, it must be very difficult, massive plan, you know, and, oh, it's going to take everybody working so hard, you know. None of that's true. There isn't some massive plan. It's very simple. just exchange, you know, what you're pretending. Change what you're pretending. We can do that. We just change what we're pretending. And all the difficulties are no longer there because we're not pretending that they're there. They don't have any, none of the difficulties, problems have any nature of their own whatsoever. None of them are separate from the mind. Not one. So Jesus doesn't have some plan. Well, how do I defeat those that are separate from the mind? You know, those are the difficult ones. You know? There isn't any plan like that. And that's what we're expecting. Say, wow, Jesus, you know, what kind of plan do you got? I mean, how are we going to defeat cancer? How are we going to defeat this stuff? And there's no plan. There's nothing that's separate from the mind. Just change what you're pretending. That's all. So he stays true to the simplicity, and which is why people have trouble relating with him, because he's just true to this simplicity. And we're like, yeah, that's great simplicity, Jesus, but what about this? You know, he says, no, that too is just in the mind. You know, there's nothing outside of the mind. Nothing works. We're not experiencing anything outside of the mind. So it's just this, he's just this resolute, just total adherence to the simplicity of it. No exceptions, no exceptions, no exceptions. So we find that difficult to relate with. We think, well, you're overlooking. That's very. We say, well, that's very nice and good, but what about the stuff that's you know, not outside the mind, or you know, coming from a different source, or has its own self nature? What about that? He says there isn't any such situation. Yeah, but the Chalcedonian Council said there was. Well, they were mistaken. Well, you're not saying that the church fathers and doctors are mistaken, are you? He said, yes, I am. He says, but they were trying to help you. Well, but they had good intentions, but good intentions are not enough. You got to get it right. You got good intentions with mistakes. You know, the good intention should be to correct your mistakes. Not to say, well, I have good intentions that I should be allowed mistakes to be true. Yeah, but we got all this history, and it says, well, you know, it was a side trip. You have a history of making a side trip. So yeah, we're not going to get Jesus off of his simplicity. We're not going to get him off of that. So if we think we are, you know, then we're going to say, oh, this guy's too problematical. I'm going to go look for somebody else, you know. He's too problematical. I can't get him on my problems, you know, the real problems, we call it. Yeah, what about the real problems, Jesus? There aren't any real problems. Yeah, but no one's going to believe that, Jesus. Well, you know, they're going to have to eventually. So I said, well, you know, very few Jesus are really going to believe you. I said, but that's okay. You come back anyway, and we'll do the best we can. You know, and when you hear it at first, it's like, wow, I can't, stressful, I can't, you know, have to readjust my mind, recalibrate, you know, where I'm coming from, that kind of thing. But yeah, that's just a wow, and you do it fast with a wow. Just say, I'm neither recalibrating nor not recalibrating. You know, you just take a complete break from it. I'm just neither responding nor not responding. I'm neither getting it nor not getting it. I'm neither understanding it nor not understanding it. So take refuge in this all the time. And the more you feel comfortable taking refuge in this, the more capability you'll have to push forward, because you know when it gets really intense, you can take this break from it. Absolutely. I'm neither practicing nor not practicing. I'm neither getting it nor not getting it. again, very unmoved in the absolute simplicity. And we want plans. We want big plans. I don't have any. I don't have any plans at the moment. What's your plan, Jesus? I mean, okay, how are you going to, you know, take control of this world and get all the bureaucracies right and do all the stuff? He says, I don't have any plans at the moment. So, are we willing to welcome back someone like that? I certainly am. And give it a try, for sure. Somebody just says, I don't have any plans at all. No, nothing. It's just, you know, exchange your pretending from one to another. That's it. You can do it. You're just pretending you can't do it because you're trying to pretend that you're dead. And if you start doing it, that'll blow your cover. Say, oh my gosh, I'm not really dead. And then guilt will say, oh, you got a long ways to go before you die. So you got to keep suffering, you know. Lots of birds coming in right here, right now, all over the place. Birds lead very active lives, don't they? They're just flitting all over the place. And they're getting some sort of something from the trees or something, yeah. Wow. Hopping all over. So yeah, when we hear, I don't have any plans, wow. Blows our mind, doesn't it? Because we thought Jesus is coming back to fix everything here. It's not the case. But then when did he ever say that? When did Jesus ever say that he was coming back to fix everything here? That he'd come back and fix everything? Where is it in the Bible that he ever said anything like that? It's not. He said that before he left, they said, where are you going? They said, well, I'm leaving this world. And, oh, well, really? Why? Well, this place is not my kingdom. And the Prince of Darkness is around. He said, but don't worry, you know, don't worry. There are many rooms of my Father's mansion. If it weren't so, I would have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And then when I come back, you will be able to go there to dwell with me. And the way and the place and the means to get there, you will know the way to get there. You will know that. So he didn't say he's coming back to be the top bureaucratic administrator of this planet, solve the problems of this planet. Never said that. Just been projected upon him, like people thinking he's coming back to right all the wrongs and get the right people in office and give the right justice here. He has no such plans. Those are plans we've projected upon him for what we desire, you know, to fix the problems that we think we can't fix for ourselves with our mind just choosing something else. We think, no, we're not able to choose something else on this. This is a real problem. So we need Jesus because only he can deal with this problem. You know, it's a real problem. Now we got to tell us how to deal with this. So sure, it would be a shock. For most people to relate with Jesus and they just say, wow, this is nothing like I expected, and all my expectations are thrown into doubt, you know. So you have to alter your expectations ahead of time, which is what I've done. did all the preparatory work ahead of time. And so people might ask me, well, what are your plans? I said, I don't have any. I don't have any plans. Not having plans doesn't mean that you won't do anything. But there's a realization the only thing that needs to be done is to change what we're pretending. That's it. That's all there is to it. There'll never be anything other than that. I seem to be quite tired now, so the strain is very significant. Maybe I'll take a rest and just keep pushing this out. Steady push, big push here. Stay ahead of the apocalypse, ride the apocalypse. Don't get inundated by it. And just keep hearing this and absorbing it. And when you get the wow comes there, just say, okay, full stop on the wow. I'm neither absorbing nor not absorbing. I'm not judging. I'm neither judging nor not judging. Don't get trapped in any way. I'm neither judging nor not judging, absorbing nor not absorbing. I'm not doing anything. I'm just neutral. And this will enable one to, the mind to, you know, adjust to this. Wow, no plans. Jesus doesn't have any plans. Wow, that's a mind blower. I thought that I'd have to be, you know, a little cog in the wheel of some vast machinery, you know, of fixing everything. And I thought that was, that's not it. Well, what do I do? Oh, imagine that I'm eternal, how that eternal life feels. Oh, wow. That's all I need to do? Yeah. That's all I need to do. That's it. I don't need any big, grandiose plans for anything.